reluctantly crouched at the starting line. Engines pumping and thumping in time. The green light flashes, the flags go up. Churning and burning, they yearn for the cup. They deftly maneuver and muscle for rank. Fuel burning fast on an empty
She used
tank.
To be an actress.
Oh, really? Did she do anything out of scene?
And I think her biggest deal was she starred in a pilot.
Pilot? What's a pilot?
Well, you know the shows on TV?
I don't watch TV.
Yeah, but you are aware that there's an invention called television, and on this invention they show shows, right?
Yeah.
Well, the way they pick TV shows is they make one show. That show's called a pilot. Then they show that one show to the people who pick shows, and on the strength of that one show, they decide if they want to make more shows. Some get chosen and become television programs. Some don't. Become nothing. She started one of the ones that became nothing.
Couch pilots, all of you are my friends. It's the show that dares to fly into the unknown territory of awful television pilots of the past. My name is Jason, and with me is the man who doesn't discriminate against the races, even the wacky ones. It's Captain Philip Race-a-Shirt. Good evening.
Good evening. I love you as well, buddy. It's a new year. It's a fresh start. I've been thinking, New Year's resolutions? We always talk about it. It's something that's fleeting for 99% of the population, right? Give it a month. Everybody gets a gym membership, and then Planet Fitness makes millions and millions of dollars for the rest of the year because people keep paying it because you have to go in there.
And then when you want to cancel, say you have to come in, and I'm too lazy to go. Yeah. Someone else is too lazy.
Yeah, it's only $10 a month. It's not worth my time or gas money that $10 every month.
That's right.
It's a great business plan, to be honest with you.
Keeping it at $10, I don't know if it's still at $10, but it is brilliant because that's what it is. It's the lure of how cheap it is,
right?
And then your unwillingness to go and actually cancel in person. Yeah, it's brilliant. It is.
There was
brilliant.
Some fat guy behind a desk that figured that out.
Yeah, for real.
For sure.
It's not a guy who's in shape who's like focused on fitness. It's a guy with a pitch perfect algorithm.
What are you going to be? You got to make one, right? It's,
what are you talking about? Resolution still. Yeah. Well, so what's my resolution? Is your question? This is my promise to the Couch Pilots Nation for 2023. I am going to lose 100 pounds this year.
You can't.
I'm going to lose 100 pounds. I've gained too much weight. I work from
100
home.
Pounds?
I love
How
soda
How much do you
pop.
Weigh?
I don't know for sure. I don't weigh myself often.
Sure.
I think I'm 220, and I could be a little north of that, but I think that's where I'm at right now.
Okay.
I don't know.
Do you think
but
it would be healthy
I'm,
to get down to 120? That's what I weighed my senior year.
I always said no one looks better than Blake Creighton senior year of high school.
No, I don't look good my senior year of high school.
You're pulling up your phone. Do you have a picture of yourself from senior year handy on your phone?
My mom recently sent me three or four of my senior pictures.
Feel free to text them to me here.
Yep. I'm going to do that here in a second, but let's talk.
But yeah, I think 100 pounds is the goal. I want to get down to my fighting weight.
Your fighting weight? How are you going to do that?
Well, I'm going to go on a paper diet. It's a Japanese paper diet. Have you heard of this? It's pretty popular, especially on the West Coast. Basically what it is that the only thing I can eat is paper, but here's the thing. I can eat as much as I want.
That's true.
So
you're not worried about your stomach or any lining?
I am 100% worried about my stomach. I'm going to lose 100 pounds. That's why I'm doing this.
Okay, we joke around. This podcast is it's what we do is we joke. We joke in life, right? We joke all the time.
I guess.
I mean, we're serious a lot, though, too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's where I am.
Are you going to make any serious resolutions? Is there anything that you want to change or do?
I get it. I'm just a stupid...
And if you say buy a penguin, I'm going to be so...
I'm just a stupid fat fuck over here who can't lose 100 pounds. Is that right? Jason's so stupid, he can't put his mind to anything, so he can't
fucking
lose weight.
Why don't you say 50 pounds, then?
Because I'd be lying, because I want to lose twice as much. And that's what I will do in the next calendar year.
Okay. All right.
I will lose that weight. I want to be able to do the things I could do when I was young, and I just can't do them anymore because of all the mass that I've put on.
I've seen the pictures.
Okay, so I'm going to look at Blake Clayton, and you really genuinely believe that you were under 130?
Oh yeah, for sure.
At the end of
high
school.
This is my senior year.
At your current height.
My Owen Mills senior pictures.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, that's a text from Dustin. Whoops. Okay.
Oh, what's more important, I guess.
So this is you, and who else is in the picture? Is that Chad?
No, that's Josh Englehop, my best friend in high school.
And so you and Josh are taking pictures together in what appears to be...
denim.
And for the people who are in the know, which I imagine a lot of people...
I'll post it to the Instagram page.
It is... I will definitely post it. You won't. I posted a picture of you on Twitter today.
Oh, did you?
Did you know that? Uh-uh. I put a picture of just your chin and just John Fetterman's chin on Twitter today. Anyway, you and your friend... What's his name? Josh Heffefoffer?
Englehop.
Josh Englehop, you're taking what I would consider to be a glamour shot. You're doing it together.
The senior pictures, it was that place up on Main that you used to get your senior pictures done.
Two dudes together. Each you're kind of at a 45 degree angle, so where you guys are
we're back to back.
Well, you're front to back, but I don't know what to call that positioning, but the one you're wearing jet black Ray-Bans. And the other one, you're with Adam and kind of smiling. Nothing wrong with this. Nothing wrong with this. I think you're wrong. I do want to look like that. Look at that.
I sent that to Josh the other day, and he goes, yeah, that's why we got picked on in high school.
I agree that two dudes taking a glamour shot together is being...
It's Owen Mills, not glamour shots.
I'll say one of six a dozen.
I'll send you one more without him and a different outfit.
I just think it's funny that two best friends are like, hey,
I know. I mean,
we've got to get in this picture together.
I know. Seriously.
This will go on Twitter.
That was probably, to me, that was like when she pulled that out of the hat, you know. To me, I was like, yeah. I mean, we were best friends. Like, we hung out together. And, like, to me, that was a good idea. Like yeah, I'm going to have my best friend in my senior pictures. I got one more coming at you.
Yeah, this is ridiculous. I can't wait to put that on Twitter for the world to see. I've never taken a picture like that. Oh, here's some more. Okay.
You didn't have senior pictures? You didn't go have senior pictures done?
Not like this.
Really?
You do have that Eminem look about you. You do look like Eminem.
With dark hair.
Yeah. Here, this is you laying on the grass.
With my golf, I had my golf shirt and my golf pants on.
And here's another one that's separate from Josh Epp and Popper. Where you had your arms crossed and you're looking dead serious while there are giant, shiny, golden bars behind you. Boy, that is fucking ridiculous. These are ridiculous, but I love them. Thank you for sharing them.
I cannot imagine how much my mom spent on senior pictures.
This is what I want to look like at the end of the calendar year. I'm going to lose this weight. Okay. I'm going to stop drinking soda every day.
Are you going to stop drinking soda?
And then,
what about beer?
Honestly, this is the last of my beer. I think I'm going to go to hard alcohol.
Yeah. It's a lot less fattening.
In just a little bit. You know, when I only drink when I'm around buddies, you know, when I podcast. So
I had a buddy that I was talking to the other day at the Moose, a raging alcoholic. Mm-hmm. And he's like, you know, he was Friday, Saturday, Sunday, I'll drink 16, 20 beers in a day and won't even bother. You know, won't even faze me.
That's 3 weeks for me.
He goes, but I mean, I just gain weight. He goes, I haven't drank a beer in a week and I've lost 10 pounds. I was like, well, that's kind of bullshit. But, and then he goes, then what are you drinking then? He's like, well, I'm drinking whiskey. Mm-hmm. And he goes, instead of 16 beers in a day, I'll have four or five whiskeys, you know, whiskey and Cokes. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, I've seen you here for 45 minutes and you've had three. What have you been doing all day? But, yeah. So
that's okay. So, it really is the key. It's, I mean, people want to say go eat a Japanese paper or whatever, but the key is calories in versus, you know, energy.
Sure.
So my goal is to lose 100 pounds, get down to Blake's high school weight. What is your New Year's resolution, Blake?
I definitely don't need to lose any weight. I would say that I have to make life choices, change some life choices. Mm-hmm. But I'm not going to say I'm not going to smoke any cigarettes. I'm not going to say I'm not going to drink, because I will fail at those. But I need to chip away at time management, what I'm saying yes to, just being at home more. Like, this basement. The only time we use it is to do laundry and then when we podcast every other week. Mm-hmm. Why did I buy a house that has two floors if I'm just wasting a whole bottom floor? You know what I mean? And it's just like, I'm not taking care of stuff. To me, the house is crumbling around me because I'm not taking care of it, because I'm not home, because I'm making poor decisions in my life in regards to what I'm doing with my time.
Okay, that's pretty realistic.
I mean, that's something you can work on as opposed to losing 100 fucking pounds in a year.
I
think you're fucking with me. I think you're serious.
I'm positive about your changes, what you want to do, and you're shitting on mine.
I'm not shitting on it. I think a goal should be 50 pounds. I think if you lost 100 pounds, we'd be visiting you in the model
agency.
Yeah, at the Vogue runway.
I would probably be looking pretty good, but you don't see a lot of 40.
Just cut your hair. That's 20 pounds right there.
Is there a lot? There's not too much hair up there.
It's getting thick on the top and the sides again.
I'm bald in the back though.
Yeah.
I'm fucking losing my hair back there. It's insane.
Is that why you never get pegged? Because you don't want the girl to see a bald head on the
back? Yeah, that's why. Can you imagine loving being pegged so much that you put it on other people why they don't want to be pegged? Can you imagine that?
I have fun with you. I'm in so much pain, but I'm having fun. We're ripping each other. We're ripping on each other. We love each other.
I would say this is what I would do if I were you. I would take a really slow and long walk around your house, and I would make a list of the things that need to be done.
You know what I did there?
And then I would start to chip away at those things. I personally like to have a full dance card. I like to be out there shaking my shit around and having fun and being with friends. But yeah, there is a time where you have to say
yes to this or no to this
and be at home working on the things you have to work on.
Or just like leisure. You know what I mean? But I did that.
Being out and having a full dance card is my leisure.
I can't do it anymore. I can't keep up anymore.
Well, that's you at the Moose. That is your free time. That is your leisure. But you like doing that. Don't tell me you can't do that anymore. You like that.
I don't. The other day, the other night, I came home. Molly was working, and it was Friday night. We got a couple beers, right? Brought them home. And I cleaned out the linen closet. We have a double linen closet. And I cleaned the whole thing out. Because every time I opened it, I was so mad. I was like, this looks awful. This is like, you know.
Yeah.
The south end of Pekin, if they even had this big a closet, that's what it would look like.
Only you can control this.
Only I can control it. And you know what I did?
You controlled it.
I took everything out. I folded stuff. I threw away stuff that we don't use or was, you know. When I got done, I closed that and I felt good.
You feel good.
And so that's why I need to go do things. I need to do things in my life that make me feel good. There are things I do in my life that I act like they make me feel good, but they don't.
Like the beer.
Well, that makes me feel good.
Some Saturday that you have off of work is what you do. You go out to your garage. You close the garage door. But I don't know if you have a heater out there. You probably do. If not, go buy a heater. And then you just spend like 3-4 hours cleaning your garage. You're gonna fret it. And then, amid doing it, you'd be like, "Oh, I'm genuinely making a big difference here." It takes someone to kick you in your ass, and hopefully, you're able to kick your own ass to where once you start doing it, you're gonna feel good. Yeah. I say, you don't have to clear out your schedule to always be at home, but check the stuff off in your house that you want to get done. Get it checked off the list, and then you'll have time for the fun stuff.
Right.
And from there on out, it's...
And I'll feel better when I'm doing the fun stuff.
You absolutely, because that thing won't be at home waiting for you. Right. You'll know you've already taken care of it. It's a five-minute-a-day rule, where if you spend 5 minutes a day working on a thing, you know, eventually it's just every day if you do that, you're never going to have to block out 3 days to do something, because every day you're working on it a little bit.
Yeah.
And And then, yeah, when you go out and do stuff that you want to do, you won't have that burden at home.
Yeah.
And, yeah, just it does it make you money or does it make you happy? And if the answer is no to both of those, then why are you doing it?
Right.
Then why are you doing it?
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right.
Got to make sure your responsibilities are taken care of.
My responsibilities.
You've been in this house for how long now? Six,
2016.
Yeah, so that's 6 years.
Six years. October 2023 will be 7 years.
So just over 6 years.
Yeah.
And you're still here. You're taking care of responsibilities. Can you tighten some things up? I suspect you could.
Oh, yeah. I can tighten up a lot in my life. My butthole.
Ladies and gentlemen, the captain.
That was unnecessary.
I don't want girls to peg me from the back because my hair loss.
The trick is to have them peg you from the front.
Now, I know that you know all the tricks. And if I ever want to be pegged by a lady, there's one phone number I'll call.
Oh, she's not the one doing it. No, I'm just joking.
Your phone number.
Oh, hey.
I'll call you. All right. So I actually did have New Year's resolutions to talk about, and we did do that. This is the animation season of Couch Pilot. Sometimes we have themed seasons. We just came off of a user-submitted season from a friend of the show, David Bobke. He gave us all failed pilots.
I hope David enjoyed it. I hope he did. He enjoyed it.
I haven't really heard anything from since then.
I didn't either.
But genuinely, I do hope that he enjoyed that season, sure. And I hope we did him right.
Yeah, that was the thing. I hope we gave him... You know, his we did proper justice.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. But this is an animation season, and we've done animation seasons before. We've done Adult Swim seasons. We've done spin-off seasons, summer CBS summer playoff seasons. You name it. We've really done it.
Yeah,
right?
we've ran the gamut.
But so this season is 10 episodes of animation, and this is episode 9, I think, of that season.
Yeah.
We tore through this season.
Yeah, it was quick.
Today we discussed the pilot episode of Wacky Races Forever from the year of our Lord 2000+7. I'll say that was a great year.
2007 was that year your daughter was born?
She was born 2006.
Oh.
But I did leave her mom that year. And then I went to Washington D.C. That was 15 years ago is when I went to our nation's capital and I got to visit the National Mall.
Okay.
You ever been to the National Mall?
No, I've never been to Washington D.C. I think if I was to go to Washington D.C., I'd just go to a Baltimore Orioles game.
Mm-hmm.
What's close, right?
You'll see the Orioles. I think Baltimore's pretty close there. Yeah,
that's what I would do. Yeah. I don't need to see all that stuff.
I think it was cool. You know, it's anytime you open a history book in grade school, you're seeing all these national monuments. I got to go up there and put my hands on them.
Yeah,
so I thought that was kind of cool.
Lincoln is huge, right? The Lincoln Monument. Massive.
30 stories.
No, seriously, that statue is big, right?
Yeah,
it doesn't look that big. It doesn't look like that, like on a picture. You're like, oh, that's
him sitting down. I bet it's about 20 feet high. It's pretty big. You seem really delighted that it's big.
No, yeah, I think, in that instance, when you see like a monument or something like that, that's like my mom has been talking about going to Egypt. You know what I mean? That's like her thing is she wants to go to Egypt. She says she's been saving for years to go. You know, but I'm like, you're gonna, and from what I've heard, like you go, you know, you want to see the Sphinx or whatever. Like, you're gonna look at it. It's not gonna be near as like overwhelming as you thought. And then you're gonna look over to your right, and there's gonna be a town with like gas station. Yeah.
Yeah, I heard they're not as big as you think, but it is pretty cool that they are there.
Sure.
And were you ever pegged in your Sphinx by chance?
Sphincters is what?
What? Hey, let's go back to 2007.
In our minds.
And to do that, we'll talk about things that happened in 2007 so we can get in the proper mind frame of when Wacky Races Forever was released, because to do it any other way would be uncivilized.
Right, because in 2007, there was a lot of things different than there are in 2023, which I can say it for the first time, 2023.
Yeah, 16 years ago.
In 2007, I'll tell you what, we did not have the Washington Generals.
That's true. Yeah, Harlem Globetrotters were just basically going out there, just doing tricks and having fun with no opponents.
Well, a lot of times they would bring like a dads in from the crowd to like
they would try to cobble together some team from people who were watching, and of course they would beat them. But finally, in post 2007 world. The Washington Generals emerged from...
Oh, yeah, and gave them a run for their money.
That's absolutely right.
In 2007, we also did not have Magnum condoms. There was nobody that had that big a dick in 2007.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm friends with a black guy. I don't want to say his name.
Humble brag.
Right. Well, yeah. But and I remember, you know, in college, he would spend his Friday nights. I'd say, "What are you doing Friday night?" I'd say, "I'm staying and I'm working on something." I was like, "What are you working on?" He's like, "Don't worry about it." I'd say, "What about Saturday? What are you doing?" I said, "I'm going out with the lady Saturday." Turns out Friday night he was sewing together condoms,
right?
Because to get ready for Saturday night, yeah. Because on Friday night he had to get condoms ready because they didn't make condoms as big for a black guy,
right? And in 2007 we did not have Elon Musk.
That's true. We didn't. So. Here's some things that we did have. January 1st, Bulgaria and Romania join the European Union, while Slovenia joins the Eurozone, which sounds kind of cool, right?
Eurozone?
Yeah.
That sounds like a movie Pauly Shore would be in.
To me, it sounds like an indoor playground for kids.
At the playground, you know?
Yeah. The Euro. I want to go to the Eurozone. That sounds rad.
It sounds like one of the theme parks, like a Disney theme park.
Yeah, I would go there.
Yeah, for sure.
Bulgaria is like a country that people use as a reference, and it makes me think that it's like a made-up country.
It's real, though.
It is real.
Yeah. They make bologna there.
They make that's where bologna comes from, is Bulgaria?
That's where it's canned.
Canned bologna? Like, are you talking about like Spam?
Oh, no. They can it and then ship it over here, and then when they wrap it and cut it up.
I had no idea.
Well, I'm just here to help, man.
January 9th, Apple CEO Steve Jobs introduces the original iPhone at a Macworld keynote in San Francisco, beginning a new era of smartphones with this invention.
And now, you know, here we are in 2023, they're having trouble getting China to get those iPhones made for us now.
Oh, are they really? Yeah, why is that?
COVID and they're just, you know, they're all backed up. They can't get parts and everything. So
That's what we should do.
Stop making parts or start making parts.
You and I should start making parts.
For iPhones?
Yeah, for iPhones.
I don't have an iPhone, so I don't.
Gorilla Glass.
Gorilla Glue? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've never had an iPhone. I've always said that I would never go to the Apple stuff. I don't know. I just think they control your life.
I don't feel like my life is controlled, or if it is in ways that I don't realize, I don't care. I've always the only smartphone I've ever had are iPhones, and I'm sure Samsung and Google phones. I'm sure they're great and they work fine, but I don't. I've honestly had an iPhone now for 12, 13 years, and I don't have problems with their phones. I don't have any problems.
That's great. I think it probably whispers that to you at night to make you say that, but.
I never have any problems with their phones. Their phones work great. I would continue to buy iPhone products going forward.
Would you buy an Apple brooch?
Sure. Yeah, all Apple products are good, and I don't have any problems with Apple products. I would continue to buy them, and I would advise others to do the same.
Why do you think that the Apple app doesn't have all of every episode we've ever had on it?
Well, I can't speak to that. I know Apple's is a... you know, they're a busy company, and they focus on the things that are most important to people. And I've never had a problem with one of their products. I would continue to buy them, and I would advise other people to buy them as well.
Do you think that the Apple company will ever come out with a partner? Like, you could buy a robot partner?
Oh, you mean like some sort of humanoid robot to provide companionship?
Yes.
Well, I know if they do, if robot companions come to the market and Apple is at the, you know, the vanguard of that partner kind of race, then I'm sure they would put out the best product possible, and I would absolutely buy it and not foresee any problems with it.
The best part of that whole thing there is that as you were talking, you would just continue to lift up your right shoulder for no reason, which I didn't understand.
It's part of the character.
Oh. I'm in so much pain.
Yeah, your pain is funny. Hey, January 31st, Boston faces a hoax bomb scare as a result of LED placards of Ignignacht and Ur from Aqua Teen Hunger Force being mistaken as improvised explosive devices.
I don't have any idea what that means.
You know what Aqua Teen Hunger Force is?
Yeah, the shake, the hamburger patty, and the fries.
That's right. They had a movie come out.
Okay.
I may have mentioned this on the show before. Okay, so it was it's like a 12-minute cartoon.
Right.
It was on Adult Swim. And they had these two characters from the moon. They were called Ignignacht and Ur. They're these two little 8-bit square characters. They're poorly drawn, purposely sure. so. And they're very rude and angry. And when they had this movie come out in, for theaters, Aqua Teen Hunger Force, they were doing kind of these rogue promotion techniques where outside of a Boston tunnel, they had put this like this, those characters in neon lights. And there's no words on them. They just put them up. And someone thought they were an explosive device, which may be the best possible promotion for the movie as possible.
You definitely got a lot of print space on that.
Hell yeah. Anyway, well, I'm back in 2007.
Yeah, I'm good.
I was 26 that year. You were 32 probably. Why did we choose to watch Wacky Races Forever?
There are three simple criteria with a bonus for this season. The bonus is that it's an animated film. One, it was a pilot television show that never went to series. Whether it aired or not is irrelevant. Number three, it had to be free.
All right.
And number four, we had to find it on the internet.
Do you say, do you go 1, 2, 4?
I went 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you, Miley Cyrus.
If I ever want you to say Miley or Miley Cyrus, all I have to do is press that.
Yeah.
I know you'll say it every time.
I'm looking forward to the New Year. Well, I enjoyed the New Year's special. It was her and Dolly Parton, the Miley Cyrus New Year's.
Oh, was it really?
Yep, Dolly Parton's the co-host.
Now,
that's her godmother.
Oh, is it for real? Mm-hmm. I know when we were growing up, it was like... What was that guy's name? Dick Clark. Clark's Rockin' New Year's.
Yep, and then it was the guy from America's Got Talent.
Dick Clark died, and they said we don't. This is kind of a classic thing that we've been doing for decades. Who will take the mantle? And I think for a while, and maybe it still is Ryan Seacrest. Is that the show that Miley Cyrus is doing?
No,
that,
she has her own.
Oh, her own special.
Yeah, her own Rockin' New Year's Eve thing.
Miley Cyrus. Is she
a smoke show? Yeah.
Because I feel like she's a girl who is like made no bones about living hard.
Yeah, I don't think she lives as hard as she used to.
No, okay. I feel like I saw her recently. I was like, I don't know. She looks pretty rough, man. Like she's been really partying these past 10 years.
She's making up for a lot of lost time, but I feel that if I bring her home and kind of clean her up a little bit, that I could probably help her life a little bit.
So you think the thing that Miley Cyrus needs more than anything else is probably you?
Yeah.
Oh, you're probably right. Hey, you can find the entire episode of Wacky Races Forever by subscribing to Couch Pilots and SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcast, or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to YouTube, Blake.
You know what to do, too.
Flight attendants, prepare for takeoff, please.
Yeah. Into the sun.
That engine sounding good. I mean, we got that New Year's tune-up.
Put that new spark plug
in. Yeah, and the DSJ gave us a good wax down for New Year's Day.
He gave the wings a good shellacking.
Oh, they needed shellacked. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about maybe doing some artwork on the side of the plane.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I haven't quite figured it out yet.
I say
we need to use it as a promotional tool. We're flying around.
We are wasting
this. We're wasting the promotional space.
Well, I always thought, you know, if we did this show, we'd get a plane together, and I want to make it cool and sleek. You know, I didn't want to do anything crazy with it, but you know what? Seasons change, and so do minds. Let's do it.
It's time to sell out, basically.
It's time to sell out. Summary of the pilot. Wacky Races Forever is an animated pilot spinoff of Hanna-Barbera's 1960s Wacky Races. What'd you think there?
Hanna-Barbera, that's the one that you liked, right?
No,
that's the one you don't like. That's yeah.
I was never a fan of Hanna-Barbera.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. I get it mixed up.
That was the summary. Are you refusing to grade it?
I'll give it a C.
I give it an interesting facts.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Interesting Facts. This is the part of the show where Jason has scoured the internet to find out facts that you may not know. All we ask is that you don't taint someone else's experience and keep your opinions to yourself. Thank you. Thank you, Miz. I appreciate it, buddy. Thank you, lady in the front. I don't, baby. I'm having a hard time right now.
Last episode, you went to the bathroom, and I had to do that by myself, that whole part.
Yeah.
I was lost. I had no idea.
Well, I'm sorry I left you hanging there.
I was crying. My brother was laughing at me. I said, I know that no matter how bad I'm hurting right now trying to do this, I know Blake is in more pain. So that's funny to me, and also I feel bad for him.
No. Well, I'm glad you got a good chuckle, and I'm glad you feel bad for me.
Interesting facts. Wacky Races was an American animated television series produced by Hanna-Barbera Productions for CBS on Saturday mornings. The series featured 11 different cars racing against each other in various road rallies throughout North America, with all of the drivers hoping to win the title of World's Wackiest Racer. The show was inspired by the 1965 comedy film The Great Race Fact. The cartoon had many regular characters, with 23 people and animals spread among the 11 race cars. Wacky Races ran Saturday mornings on CBS from September 14, 1968 to January 4, 1969, and in syndication from 1976 to 1982. 17 20-minute episodes were produced, with each of them featuring two 10-minute segments. Fact.
Fact.
September 14th, 1968 to January 4th, 1969. That's like 4 or 5 months the show ran.
Wow. I thought it would be a lot longer.
Still talking about today.
That's crazy.
In 2006, the pilot for a spinoff series titled Wacky Races Forever was produced by Cartoon Network. Fact. The series depicted a roster of both new and returning racers competing against each other. Penelope Pitstop and Peter Perfect had married and created Perfect Industries, the corporate sponsor of the new Wacky Races, whereas their children, Parker and Piper, competed in the race. Fact. What's that?
I can't say anything because...
You have thoughts germinating?
I have thoughts germinating.
Okay.
In my loins.
Other characters included the Slag Brothers, Professor Pat Pending, depicted here with a mad scientist personality, a teenage version of the Gruesome Twosome, and Dick Dastardly and Muttley working for a new villain named Mr. Viceroy, who sought to steal Perfect Industries. Fact. And I have got a whole list here. I won't go through them all, I guess, but I have a list, not only of all of the names of the cars from the original series,
oh, geez,
but each of the people that were in those cars. And then I also have information about who won first, how many times each car won first, second, third, and their complete totals, which is insane. There's a lot of information here.
Hopefully that was a screenshot.
It is. Okay. A screenshot.
Okay.
I assume that you reckon... first of all, end of interesting facts.
Thank you. Oh, thank you for it. There's more... We found out more about this pilot during interesting facts than we do watching the pilot.
We should mention this pilot is 5.5 minutes long. This is easily... This is in our top, I bet, 5 of our shortest pilots. Right. We've had some short ones. You had a thought germinating earlier. Do you want to regurgitate? No,
that's what my thought was. It's like I learned more about it than by watching.
Did you recognize any of these characters?
Yeah, Muttley for sure, and the Dastardly guy or whatever. And then I recognized, these are those cars, and they're on that race. I didn't remember what it was called, Wacky Races, but... Those are really the only ones that I recognized.
Well, Dick Dastardly and Muttley were a team in the original series. They're back here. And do you know the name of their vehicle?
No, I do not.
The Mean Machine.
Oh.
Which is a pretty cool name. Now, I had mentioned that I have a list of all 11 original racers and how many times they won first and second and third place. How many times do you think Dick Dastardly and Muttley won those races?
Zero.
That's right.
Yeah.
They never won any race.
Well, on this pilot, I think they're buried just a few feet away from the finish line, and they go the other way.
They're inches from success.
Right.
They throw it in the rubbish bin. Twitter responses. Yawning response is what I should say. That's what I meant to say. Yawn through it. Sing through the yawn.
Twitter responses. I bet you Jason got some Twitter responses.
I wish I did. I didn't get any. I'm on what is considered a classic cold streak.
That's
right
okay, because when you hit it, you're a banger.
I think I'm gonna blame it on the holidays. celebrate.
For sure.
Hey, let's go ahead and break down the 5.5-minute pilot, Wacky Races Forever. I have a surprisingly large amount of notes because, you know, even if you have a small pilot, it has to be action-packed to tell any kind of story. So they cram it in, don't you think?
Yeah, there's a lot of information for sure.
We start out in a jungle environment. It's peaceful, quiet. A monkey goes for a banana, and then wham, a large rock/dinosaur vehicle hits the monkey, and the small primate holds on for dear life. The vehicle here that we see mirrors the original team of the Slag Brothers, who drove the Bouldermobile, and the two drivers look like a cross between Captain Caveman and the Adams Family It.
Yeah.
That's what they look like here.
Now I remember it for sure.
But the prehistoric pair are quickly electrocuted by a mad scientist character that drives his high-tech vehicle from a glass sphere that can like move about the vehicle and move in different directions away from the vehicle. But he's controlling it from a glass sphere. And this is Professor Pat Pending, which is, what do you think about that name?
Pat Pending? Oh, no, I cannot believe you, like, I mean, you like raw dogged, like you went.
I had sex without a condom.
You went deep into this pilot, writing stuff down.
I did. There is history here.
But I'm just saying, when you're breaking down the pilot, I mean, how many times did you watch it?
I think I watched it twice.
You wrote all that stuff down.
I watched it once. This is what I did. I watched it once uninterrupted, and then I went back and watched it slowly and paused it and made notes. Okay. That's what I did. But this character, his name of his car is the Converticar, because his car can change and do a lot of different things because he's a scientist.
Okay.
Anyway, this character is very clearly insane. Absolutely nutso things are happening to this guy, and he's smiling and cackling the whole time.
Kind of like me and you when we fly this plane.
I think it's pretty similar to that. Are you going to make it? I'm going to read the next line. Is that all right? Or do you want to chime in here? No? All right. Coming up behind the scientists, Professor Pat Pending, is a pair of spooky goth characters. This is the gruesome twosome, or at least the new version of them. They're both pale. One's a guy with a large, veiny, bald head. The other's a teen girl. They send a swarm of bats out of their car into the windshield of Pat Pending, kind of veering him off the road. And the team kind of mirrors the original gruesome twosome in their vehicle, which is called the Creepy Coupe, which is pulling some very serious Munsters and Addams Family vibes. The vehicle even looks like a smaller version of one of their houses, you know, kind of that old wooden creaky house, and just they look very gothic and kind of like spooky characters. I'm going to keep talking because Blake's not here. Hey, the goth car sees Parker Perfect coming up behind him, so the Creepy Coupe releases Fido, a massive three-headed dog with a spiked chain, to attack him. The dog grabs onto Peter's vehicle, Parker's vehicle. Parker hits the brakes, stretches out the dog, and then Parker blasts over the top of the gruesome twosome. And just as Parker is enjoying his first place lead, his father, the original wacky racer Pete Perfect, who I noticed during my research, his vehicle was called the Turbo Terrific and looks just like a penis. Looks like a big, erect penis. His dad calls Parker on a hologram phone directly to his son's dashboard. So as he's driving, he can see a little hologram figure of his dad, and his dad's talking to him. Parker is annoyed that his dad is calling during the race, but Peter wants to talk about his sister, Parker's sister, Piper. At the same time, Piper is also in the race, and her mom, Penelope, her name used to be Penelope Pitstop, but now she's Penelope Perfect because she married Peter.
And those were the two that used to race in the old one.
That's right.
Okay, just, yeah.
And she wants to talk to Piper about her brother, Parker. Now, I'm going to pause real quick here. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm all right.
You pooping fire?
No, it's not. I'm not. Nothing's coming out.
Nothing's coming out either?
No, it's that's not what it's obviously it's like an ulcer.
What are we going to do about that?
I'm going
to wait it out.
Take a huge shower, a real hot shower, and then lay down.
Wait for death?
Yeah. Sorry. I apologize.
No, it's fine. Parker and Piper are very competitive. Peter, the father, shows his son a new bridge his company built. His company is called Perfect Industries. Blake, won't you please tell me about this bridge?
This bridge, his dad is so excited about. They built out of snakes. It's a snake bridge. And I didn't write down how much they had spent.
$16 million.
On a snake bridge. And, you know, all these snakes are alive.
When he said this, I was like, oh, okay, so I'm looking at it from above when they're talking about it, and it looks like a snake. Like, okay, so it's snake bridge because it looks like a snake. And they said it's made out of snakes. Yeah. And I was like, do they, like, skin all these snakes? Or do they, like, would they encase them in, like, lucite or right. cement to make this bridge? Not the case at all. Nope, they're all just, alive.
They're all alive, and they're all just sitting there being a strong force so cars could go over it.
And Peter says, hey, you know what, son? I'm talking to you on the phone right now. If you don't believe me, it's made out of snakes. Hey, this guy right here, the Viceroy, he works for me. He can confirm. And so he brings in this weird little guy with a suit on, right?
Right.
Then Piper, his sister, she smacks into her brother Parker as they enter the snake bridge with all the other contestants hot on their heels. Everyone's kind of right in a bunch there.
And why are our brother and sister the only people that don't have a partner driving, and they're against each other?
I don't know. We cut to Dick Dastardly now and Muttley, who are not only reprising their roles from the original show, but they're also in the same vehicle from the original show, the Mean Machine. They, too, are in the race and are sitting still at the finish line facing the wrong direction.
With a big slice of cheese in front? Like a ramp? Cheese ramp?
They get that out of the machine eventually, but they first get a call from that little guy, the Viceroy. And he says, hey, don't focus on trying to put a wedge between Piper and Parker. Focus. Just win the race today. Just do that. And so the Viceroy, we find out, is kind of this secret evil character. And a mole in Perfect Industries trying to take it over.
Right.
So that could be an overarching theme for the series if it.
Yeah, and that's when they kind of pan out to where it shows that they're right by the finish line.
Yeah, and even though they could easily win, Dick wants to drive a large wedge of cheese into his competitors and win the race that way. He doesn't want to win if he can't do it without cheating. He wants to win by ill-gotten gains.
Right.
And he takes off in the wrong direction to slam his opponents with this big block of cheese.
That's so crazy.
Peter then calls his son back and tells him there's a surprise coming, and the snakes are being awakened. They were all sleeping while they drove over them, but now something Peter has done has awakened the snakes.
It's insane.
The racers make their way through the snake bridge. The snakes start jumping on the windshields and some of the racers' faces, and the bridge itself comes apart.
Obviously, right? If you have all these live snakes, eventually that bridge is going to come apart.
But like, it comes apart as though it's like a rope bridge cut from the side that they were entered on, so it like swings down to one side as though it's still attached to one side. It starts to sag and then completely swings to the side of the cliff. The racers are horrified, but Parker keeps it cool and drops down to the bottom of the bridge where his vehicle is hanging on. He puts on some spike tires. And then he tears ass up to the side of the cliff and high into the air, bringing the whole bridge and all of the race contestants with him.
Right, and there's like they have like snakes hanging off of them.
Pretty much.
Like, you know, just individual snakes like after them back.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Just as Parker arcs over the land and all the racers soar towards the land, Dick Dastardly blasts through underneath them with what's left of the snake, and he goes through the snake bridge or whatever's left of it. And he falls off the side of the cliff.
He should have just turned around, put it in reverse.
He lands in a big pile of snakes on the ground with a big thud. Dick runs off frightened, yelling drat, while Muttley just sits there with snakes in his hands and laughs.
Right. He's used to this.
That's about it. That's it.
Please remain seated as we are now crossing a zone of turbulence.
Why the show didn't work? 5 minutes. Clearly meant to be a comedy. I think they accomplished that.
An homage, for sure.
Yeah, maybe an maybe an homage is the right way. It's definitely like a spiritual successor or a reboot or a sequel to the original show. I was aware of Wacky Races. Out of all the Hanna-Barbera stuff, that's the one that I always thought was interesting because I felt like I was seeing a competition. It just felt different than other Hanna-Barbera stuff. Do you remember watching it growing up?
I was probably a little bit older than you, but I remember watching it, and you know, it was excitement. It was jam packed. There wasn't a lot of people like standing around talking. You know, they're all in their cars.
A lot of movement.
They're all communicating in their cars or racing against each other. So there was a lot of stuff was going on.
I always thought that was an interesting idea.
Yeah.
Anytime you took a bunch of characters, and I don't know these individual characters had like life outside of these shows or had their own programs. I think Penelope Pitstop went on to have like a spinoff series with another one of the cars or something. But like by and large, anytime you group a bunch of characters together, like Who Framed Roger Rabbit? That was a crazy movie where they had Disney characters interacting with Warner Brothers characters. Like they crossed over different companies, and I always think that's cool when there's a big crossover event, whether it's within a company or even outside of it.
This is kind of like the Cannonball Run movies, but as a cartoon.
Yeah, I think Cannonball Run maybe came later, but it said it was based off of The Great Race.
Right.
But yeah, anytime you have some big mishigosh of people together like that is interesting. And this is just trying to replicate that success. But I had no idea that the original run of the show was only like 4 months.
No, neither did I.
That's crazy, right?
Very crazy. Just think how many times I replayed that.
Absolutely. It says it was in syndication for like 6 or 7 years right. after that. They only had a handful of episodes.
Easy money.
Man alive. But what'd you do to improve this?
I guess I didn't have enough backstory, maybe. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't know... I don't know. We always say that sometimes they spend too much time on backstories, but I didn't know what was going on in regards to...
When it opens, we're in the middle of the race.
Yeah, we're in the middle of the race. I didn't know about the parents getting married or anything, and the brother and sister, until they started talking to their parents. Mm. And, you know, I knew who Dirk Diggler, that guy was, and Muttley, but it was intense right off the bat. It was fast. And, like... When you went through all the interesting facts, I'm like, oh, okay, that makes sense now. Why didn't I get some kind of like 45-second like narration of like what's going on?
I feel like in those old Wacky Races, we saw the beginning of the race, and we definitely saw the end because there are stats out there of who won and when and for which race. So when we start in the middle of the race, and we really don't get a definitive who won, when they land off the Snake Bridge... And as Dick Dastardly and Muttley are falling over, we can see the racers. We can kind of see an order, and the finish line is right there, and we can make assumptions. But it is wacky, and anything can happen, even in the last few feet. So we don't get any real definitive start or end, which I think would help with the story, the narration of the show.
That's what took me, jolted me for sure.
We're just thrown right in the middle of it. If it survived. I think this could be another case where this, if it's on Adult Swim, it's only 12 minutes long. If it's going to be on some other channel in a half-hour format, I think you still get 2 episodes in that half hour.
Right.
I don't think this thing needs to be more than 12 minutes apiece.
No, not at all.
I just remember watching it when I was young, and there's no real sense of distance or time when you're watching it. You're just seeing these little segments where one car screws over another, and then the next scene... It doesn't have to make any sense with what you just saw. You're just seeing the next thing happen until you see that final checkered line to cross over for the finish.
Yeah, you don't have to. Nobody has to in the show tell you what place everybody is in as you go, because that doesn't matter. It's you start the race, who screws who how, and then at the end of the race, and this person crosses. That's great. I'll believe it.
A bunch of different wild exotic locales.
Wacky.
I want wacky locales too. We should really make a note of that. Wacky locales. Really digging into some of these characters. I think we only have 5 racers here.
Yeah.
Right? We've got the mad scientist. Oh, Dick Dastardly, Piper, Parker, the caveman, and the goth. So 6.
The goths, yeah.
5 that were really racing each other, and then Dick Dastardly just kind of going against
them. Going against the other way.
So, I mean, I would say go back to those 11 racers, whether it's the same racers from the beginning or the next generation somehow, like Parker and Piper were the next
generation.
The
racers' kids or like their offspring or something. Yeah.
Something like that. Or maybe even get the band The Offspring in it. Who knows? I'd love to see Dexter Holland racing. That'd be great, wouldn't it?
For sure.
Was that a Offspring song you were just singing?
Yeah, but I started to do it, and I am just in pain. Sorry. I apologize.
All right. sorry, I was trying to thought I was lost. Hey, this is where we talk about where other people have seen and rated and reviewed Wacky Races Forever. It is on IMDb on a scale from 1 to 10 decimal points in play. Blake, what do you think people from around the world rated Wacky Races Forever?
6.5.
I see a 6.6.
Ooh.
And I see it out of 10 ratings. Critic reviews. Mark Pellegrini from AIPTComics.com says, honestly, I really liked it. Brandt and Cervone find a nice middle ground, updating the formula of the series with centralized protagonist characters and an ongoing plot, but not at the expense of the original This Is the Only Thing Crazier Than Speed Racer gimmick. Yeah. Viewer reviews. World of Coyote 2556 1 year ago says, this should have been on Kids WB. Would have been a major part of my childhood. Harold Potter, 1943, 7 months ago, says, why this show was never made confuses me to this day. Agent Prime, 2179, says, I wish we had gotten this instead of that other reboot. I think there was another reboot in like 2017 or something. At least it looked like they would have been racing more, though I'm not sure if I like the idea of Dick Dastardly working for someone. He thinks he's a lone wolf, perhaps. Ooh.
Stormy Daniels.
Stormy Daniels at P on Prez says, I must admit, Jim Cummings did a great Dick Dastardly impression here. That's the person who took over the voice acting role. And I agree. He did a good job. Last one. Princess Peach Fan 1009 says, it may have been cheap, and I really don't like the idea of the original characters not being focused on much instead of having relatives, but the characters actually look and sound like themselves. There you go.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to FCF Airport. Local time is 11:11, and the temperature is 69 degrees. For your safety and comfort, please remain seated with your seatbelt fastened until the captains turn off the fastened seatbelt sign.
Bing bong. This is the part of the show where we grade Wacky Races Forever. We've given you a lot of information. Like if you okay, so I'm going to pull back the curtain a little bit. What's the sound like when you pull back the curtain? That's right. That's a wet curtain. I should have been more specific. Sure. But we just had Thanksgiving.
Right.
It's not actually the new year. All right, guys. Right. It's Thanksgiving. I'm with my family, you know? And if I said, tell me about Wacky Races Forever, they'd have no idea.
Right.
I say, give me some information about Wacky Races Forever. They don't know.
No, they'll just look at you like you're a crazy person.
Tell me some interesting facts. They'd look at me like, got any more pumpkin pie?
Got some whipped cream?
But here's the thing. We did that for you.
Yeah.
We gave you all the information, all right? We gave you the banter. You said, how much weight should Jason lose? Blake says, I think he should lose 100 pounds. And he's standing by that. I think I should lose maybe 50 is a more appropriate goal, but you're adamant that I lose a triple digits. That's fine. I'll take your word for it. You said I should look like you in high school. I'll do my best, I suppose. Blake, please tell people how we can rate this using our scoring system.
Yeah, our scoring system is a 1 through 7. It's based off of the television show Wings, one of the greatest television shows ever made. And it's each number is represented by a character. A 1, that's the worst you can be. That's a Roy Biggins. And a 7 is the best you can be. It's a Brian Hackett.
Captain Philip, rest assured, I turn towards you. How do you rate Wacky Races Forever?
For nostalgia purposes, it was cool to see. Muttley is pretty cool. I just didn't know what the hell was going on. I mean, yes, I understand you're racing, but who's this talking to the mother and how they know each other? I got confused.
You are thrown in the middle of this.
Give me 10 minutes. Give me 10 minutes, not 5. Give me 10.
That's so weird that you would ask for more time on a pilot. It's the weirdest thing.
I felt like you just jumped in the beginning of it. Yeah, I mean, just jumped right in the middle of it. I'm going to give it a 3. I didn't really like it very much, but.
Well, you had kind of called it out by happenstance earlier. I am not a fan of Hanna-Barbera, but they exist to this day, and they continue to produce properties, mainly rehashing old stuff. I get it. Sure. If it made money for you once, there's a good chance it'll make money for you again. I don't like Hanna-Barbera. This is the best in terms of animation I've ever seen from Hanna-Barbera.
Oh, wow.
All the old stuff, it's junk. It's junk animation. It's cheap, crap animation. And maybe they put even less effort into making this animation, but maybe the technology's so much better that it looks better. I don't know. I don't care.
Right.
I'm not over there tapping their shoulder, telling what their deadlines are with the animation. I'm just here watching it, you know, 16 years later. I like what I saw, though. I thought the cartoon, it looked good. I love the old wacky races, the weird cars that would do stuff, the weird characters that inhabited each car. Each car has a name.
Sure.
Some of them have reached iconic status where people have gone out
and
physically rebuilt them in life size or even in models. Yes. I think that's cool. I like that there was this sequel to a series that maybe was a hit around 4 months. I don't know if it was a hit or not. Yeah, maybe. But it has resonance, and people think about it, and people know it still. I liked Wacky Races. I thought the story was fun. I would have liked it to have been 10 or 12 minutes. I want to see a start. I want to see a finish. Viceroy, maybe having an arc of trying to take over Perfect Industries, you know, every season or maybe one season. Maybe they switch up the characters. I don't know how. I don't know.
Right.
I liked what I saw. It could have been better. I think I'm going to give this a 5.
Okay.
I enjoyed it. I would watch more of this if it were available. I think you and I agree that we would like a little bit longer of an episode.
Yeah. 10 minutes.
My score of a 5, your score of a 3. We'll close the book on Wacky Races Forever, and we'll never mention that show again.
Forever.
But join us, please, on our next episode, won't you, when we finish out our Animation Domination series as we watch the pilot episode of Carmen Got Expelled. Here's a little something to wet your whistle. Carmen is a rebellious young girl who has been expelled by every school she takes part in until she meets the Baron, owner of a private academy he enrolls her into. Carmen must now do whatever it takes to avoid being expelled again. You can find the entire episode of Carmen Got Expelled by subscribing to Couch Pilots and SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to YouTube, and you know what to do, Tube.
I envision this like a Powerpuff Girls kind of art. Am I close?
I can't remember. You might be right. I watched maybe 30 seconds of it before we did this just to make sure it still worked. The link worked, yeah. It does. At the time of announcing we'll do it, the link does work. Right. It doesn't always happen. Sometimes it doesn't.
Your iPhone's probably telling the person right now.
You know what? I've never had a problem with an iPhone. And as long as Apple keep producing Apple products in the future, I'll go ahead and keep buying them, you know?
Yeah.
As long as they keep working, which they have. They work perfectly for me.
That's great.
Love iPhones.
You also carry around a big square battery with you all the time.
Thank you. I didn't ask you to do that. Thank you very much. Oh, that was very nice. Hey, I do want to take special note here as we wind down the episode to just make a quick note of saying that we like to build up a buffer of shows in case emergencies happen to where we can't release, because we have, some would say, an unprecedented streak of Mondays releasing. And we build up a buffer, and sometimes usually you, will pick away at the buffer. And we did that a lot recently to the point where when your stepdad died, we didn't have a lot of shows in the bank ready to go. And I said, Blake, come up with a plan on how to build this buffer. You did. You stuck to it. We executed it. And I feel very good about the buffer we have right now. So I want to thank you for making that plan and sticking to it.
Hey, no problem. I've enjoyed it.
There's no way you've enjoyed it. Marty was cool.
No, Marty. No, I have
watching Kevin masturbate over him was cool.
I have enjoyed it. Again, I am doing too much stuff to where it gets to be a certain point of the night. Plus, I feel like shit right now. That's the other part of it. So, I apologize for you having to like man the reins.
Well, will you promise me one thing?
Huh.
I'm going to leave here shortly. I don't live here with you. That's ridiculous. Right. When I leave, if there is something, if you are having a medical event. I know you have other people probably ahead of you that would help you, but if you need me, I want you to call me if you need me.
Sure.
Will you do that for me?
Yeah, I will.
Okay. I'm being genuine. I want you to do that.
I'm going to try a couple things, but yeah.
I know your stomach is hurting. It's unlike anything you've experienced before.
Oh, no. I mean, it's an ulcer. It's just.
When I leave, too, Google apple cider vinegar. I think there are people, seriously, who take shots of it. I think it's a rough thing, but once it hits your stomach, it neutralizes a lot of stuff.
I'll see if we have. I don't know if we have any of that.
I'll go get you something.
No, I'm not going
to
make you do that.
I won't do that.
Okay.
Go to couchpilotspodcast.com. It's got all of our past episodes. You can hear them all. Send us an email at couchpilotspodcast@gmail.com. And tell us what your New Year's resolutions are.
Yes,
for sure. If I like them, I'll respond. And if I don't like them, I'll probably still respond.
Yeah, definitely check it out. Some interaction. 2023, let's get some more interaction.
That's right. Twitter and Facebook, you can find out stuff there. I do a lot on Twitter where I Sometimes I'll post pictures of Blake's chin, and I'll compare it to senators' chins. That's a good one. And when this episode comes out, I will post the picture of Blake and his glamour shots with his other buddy. Can I leave it your buddy's face in there?
Okay.
Sometimes I blur out
people's faces. Black hole sun, won't you come?
Hung himself to death. Sometimes you gotta die.
Sometimes you gotta know when to hold him and know when to fold him.
Anything else you want to talk about before we end?
No, get ready. We're just a couple weeks away from me starting to announce the details for CouchCon 2023. I'm super excited. I put a lot of work into it. I said, Jason, take this off. You're doing a lot of stuff. Take some time off in regards to CouchCon. Let me do 2023. So I'm kind of proud of myself.
I'm proud of you too. Keep up the great work. We have a lot to talk about with CouchCon, and this pilot may have been rough, but it's always a smooth flight here on Couch Pilots. Thanks, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
Goodbye if I'm not dead.